Gotu Kola, Hydrocotyl centella asiatica, a plant in the carrot family, the Apiaceae. Gotu Kola is Sinhalese for cup leaf, and you can see how the leaves somewhat resemble a cup, especially if you put in a large dollop of imagination. The plant contains glycoside saponins, specifically the compound known as asiaticoside, also volatile oils, tannins, and vitamin C. It's well known to be a plant of spiritual enhancement, and sometimes it's in Ayurveda, it's called BRAHMI, which derives from the god Brahma in the Hindu pantheon, known as the creator and also associated with intellect. So the plant is used for sharpening the intellect. It also is related to spiritual enhancement and can be, is edible. You can consume it right in the garden, or you can dry it and make tea or a tincture. Can be made into a fresh tincture as well. And also, often in the tropics, it is juiced, the fresh leaves are juiced and drunk as a life-promoting, longevity-promoting, spiritual-enhancing beverage. So it grows in full sun situation or part shade and in rich soils, and likes a lot of moisture. It's a creeping plant. These are known as stoloniferous creepers. That is, it's an above ground creeping habit. And that's the way that the plant moves out from its core and gets larger and larger. And you can see that it will root in at the nodes. So if you find a node that's rooted, this can be removed from the plant and replanted into a pot or into the garden at a distance. And that's the way to make Gotu Kola clones. Just got buzzed by a hummingbird. The plant promotes collagen synthesis. It's a kind of a complicated metabolic process by which the human body produces proteins. And so it's well known to promote the growth of hair, skin, and nails. So if a person has that kind of an issue, losing hair, splitting nails, skin that's less than optimal, then having Gotu Kola in the diet will help ameliorate that situation. It also owes its activity to saponin glycosides. And in the human body, saponins are poorly digested. The saponins bind with LDL cholesterol in the gut, specifically in the duodenum, which is located between the stomach and the small intestine, and neutralizes the fat and brings it harmlessly out of the body. So it can help lower your LDL cholesterol to take in plants that contain saponins, whether they're triterpenoic or glycoside-related saponins. It also resembles some other plants, and I find that people claim that they have Gotu Kola in their garden, and being that it's a tropical plant that's rather unusual, I usually take this with a grain of salt. Here's a common mallow. You can see how closely resembling the leaves are, although the leaves of the mallow have this very dark coloration at the indentation of the leaf. Also resembles ground ivy. Also resembles plants in the pennywort family, which are common in the eastern states and also in the tropics. Those are water plants in the family Araliaceae. So they are not it. Properly identified Gotu Kola is a plant that you get from strictly medicinal seeds or some other verified source, and you can move on from that. I'm going to go in and tell some stories and also show some pictures of another Brahmi, Bacopa manieri, which is similar in many ways, and I'll be comparing and contrasting the two plants.
Stories of Gotu Kola, Hydrocotyl asiatica, the water leaf, good for longevity. So I lived in Des Moines and went to high school there. If you walked down 30th Street and you kept walking and walking, eventually you'd come to Drake University, and on the corner of the college there was a head shop there that was called Elysian Fields. I liked to go there and browse around. It was all imported Indian and Nepali stuff. The whole place smelled like Nag Champa incense. And they had a herb selection too, and I was not really very cognizant of the herb world at that time. It was the early 70s. I looked at the different bottles that they had up on the shelf, and one of them caught my eye. It said, Gotu Kola. So I asked the proprietor, well, what's that for? And he said, it is used for imbuing long life. And I said, well, you know, I should really try some of that, because I'd like to live for a long time. And I don't really believe in this stuff. It sounds kind of magical to me, but I might as well try it at least once to make sure that I've kind of got that option taken care of. And so he poured some of the kind of gray green herb into a little bag, and a little paper bag, I remember it was. And on the way back home, walking back down 30th Street, I took a pinch out of the bag and I put it on my tongue, and it didn't taste that great. It tasted kind of like hay. And these days I know what the taste of Gotu Kola is. It has a very particular sort of slightly soapy taste to it that I wasn't getting at that time. Flip forward to the early 80s. I was working in herbs at that time, and I did know something about Gotu Kola. I had tasted the good quality herb. I had grown it myself, but I was in with the herbal crowd, and one of the common stories was that in the old days, that would date back to about the time when I first tasted the herb, it was all imported from India. And if you know about where Gotu Kola grows, it grows in nutrient rich places that are very moist. And so it's basically a Indian ditchweed. And so it was lucky that I didn't get cholera by putting it straight in my mouth. And then another little aspect of that is that somebody said they imported a large bag of Gotu Kola from India, and when they went through to sort it out and high grade the material, they found a hubcap in it. In my African travels, I kept an eye out for Gotu Kola because I wanted to compare it. It has different ecotypes. There's like an Asian type that has a sort of a rounder leaf and more serrations on it. And there's a Hawaiian type that has more of a flatter leaf that has fewer indentations around it. And it's more lobed in outline. So I was walking on the Mount Kenya with a kind of paramilitary guy who was my guide, and he was there to make sure that I didn't get lost. And also he had a big gun with him in case, I don't know, if we met bandits or if we got attacked by a wild buffalo or something, he could scare it away. And of course, he's used to giving people guides who want to see animals. And so he stops me and he says, look back through the brush over there. There's a bunch of water buffalo. I couldn't care less about the water buffalo. I was standing in the midst of a patch of Bryophyllum pinnatum, which is the life plant. And it was the first time I'd been in wild life plants in my life. And so I was really transported by the plants and was only interested in the buffalo in that they should stay away from me. And the guy was really impatient, but I had a camera that I had two lenses. One was a sort of a medium range lens that I used for taking a picture of the plant in habitat. And the other was a close-up lens that I used for taking pictures of showy flowers and leaf forms and things like that. So in between the photographs of each plant, I had to change the lenses, and he was very impatient about that. Finally, we made our way up the mountain and came to a airstrip, and we crossed the airstrip and went into the green field beyond there. And there was a pit, a little pit, and inside the pit was growing Gotu Kola, again, growing in the lower moister places. And so I was extremely excited about the Gotu Kola. And as I took pictures of it and started to change my lenses and so forth, I heard him clear his throat. I looked up and there was a large elephant walking towards us. And the guide was concerned. He said, oh, that's a rogue male elephant. They are known to attack people. And so he put his gun up to his shoulder and he fired a warning shot above the elephant, which caused it to turn around and run away. But then the elephant turned around once again and faced us again. And the guide said, we'd better run. And so I never got a chance to really examine the Gotu Kola to the extent that I wanted to, because we ended up running back down the mountain. And as we ran, the rain came down and I realized that my day was over and the rain had washed away all of our fears. Gotu Kola is easy to propagate by stoloniferous cuttings, the way I demonstrated earlier on in the video, but it can also be grown by seed. Growing by seed is much more difficult, but it is possible to do it. Gotu Kola seeds are syncarps. That is, they're two seeds locked together like this. And you can just plant them that way. If both seeds are going to germinate, then you'll have two seedlings right close together. But in any case, the best method that I've worked out to plant Gotu Kola seed is to plant it directly on potting soil in a little pot like this. Sprinkle the seed around so that there's some distance between them. Pat it down a little bit and then cover with volcanic pumice all the way up to the rim of the pot. Then put the pot in a very warm place like a greenhouse or under grow lights and water directly down through the pumice. The pumice has a couple of different things that it serves. One is that it keeps the seed in place. The other is that the Gotu Kola, although it likes to live in moist places, it also appreciates intense drainage. So it germinates up through the pumice, and you'll see the little cotyledons, the rounded cotyledons, laying on the surface of the pumice, and then the true leaves will form after that. The other is that the pumice catches the solar energy and warms up. And so the combination of a moist substrate and a warm top dress like that is very, very functional for starting Gotu Kola seeds. We're comparing and contrasting the two Brahmis. This is the Brahmi that is Bacopa manieri, and the other Brahmi was our Gotu Kola. So Bacopa is a creeping plant, just like Gotu Kola. It is in the family Scrophulariaceae. Sometimes people say it's in the Plantaginaceae and has a kind of a thick leaf like that. I can think of it as like a plantain leaf almost. And it has inside of it saponin glycosides, which are just the same as the active compounds that are found in Gotu Kola. But it also has an alkaloid. Alkaloids are nitrogen-based molecules, and they're generally very, very bitter. You can think of like the berberine in Oregon grape or in golden seal. It's very bitter. And so the bitter alkaloid that's in BRAHMI is called bramine, which is very convenient. And what this does is it improves the activity, the firing off of the neurotransmitters in the human electric system, the nerve system. So it promotes cognitive function. It enhances memory, attention, and learning. So if you're going in for your SAT test, you can take a little piece of BRAHMI and chew on it before your SAT test. Bacopa responds really well to cloning. That is, just taking a piece of the stolon that has some roots on it and replanting that in fresh soil. So here we go, getting it nice and deep down in there. All the roots go straight down. And that's our new little Bacopa plant. It also will make seed pods. And there's a seed pod right next to the flower. And those seed pods, if allowed to mature for a very long time, will grow and swell and become gravid with seeds. And then they become somewhat transparent and they can be picked off. They'll be dry at that point, and you can grind them up a little bit and over a piece of white paper, and the tiny, tiny black seeds will fall out. And those tiny black seeds can be surface sown and pressed in and kept moist and warm. And they eventually will make a seedling of the Bacopa, but it is generally a lot easier to clone with cuttings than it is to plant from seed. So plant plenty of seeds. That's the way that we can be of positive support to nature in this world. And may you always remember to take a little piece of BRAHMI before you go in for testing.